My treats are always quite nice. So
okay, good.
They're not retreated that frequently now. Okay, after you.
Okay. Go ahead.
On. Good morning, everybody. Welcome to the Citizens Dialogue with Commission Vice President for Euro and Social Dialogue, Mr. Valdis Dombrovskis, coming from Latvia, and welcome to European Commissioner for Competition, Mrs. Margrethe Vestager, coming from Denmark, as you all know. Thank you very much for joining us today here in Copenhagen. I'm Nynne Bjerg Christensen, I'm going to be the moderator of today for the next 1.5 hours. The concept of today is really very, very simple. The aim is to get as many questions through from the audience to the commissioners. I'll probably have a few hand votes. We'll begin with a hand vote, and there'll be one in the middle and one in the end. But basically, we'll see if we can have as many questions from the audience coming through to the commissioners. We'll try to keep the questions within two fields. The first field will be related to the commissioner's portfolio and field. That's primarily the euro. It could be labor market, it could be economic stability, it could be the EMU, the single market, growth and jobs, and so on. And when it comes to Mrs. Vestager's portfolio, it's primarily competition, obviously. So we'll try to keep the first questions to that, and then around halfway, we'll see if we can change into sort of more general EU issues related maybe to Brexit, to immigration, to youth unemployment, or whatever you prefer to ask about. But try and keep questions in the beginning related to the commissioner's field, and then in the end, we'll try and keep questions to general EU issues. And I think they'll both be happy to ask and answer any questions related to general EU issues. But I'm thinking, Mr. Dombrovskis, maybe you can just say a few words about yourself and what you're currently working with.
So, good morning, everybody. First of all, thank you for coming. Thank you for this interest in citizens' dialogues and European Union affairs. Well, as regards myself, I'm Valdis Dombrovskis. I'm Vice President of European Commission, responsible for Euro and social dialogue, dealing with EU's fiscal and macroeconomic governance issues, budgetary policies, questions related to economic and monetary union or Eurozone-related questions, and also social dialogue and social affairs. And since the British referendum, since June of the last year, when British Commissioner Jonathan Hill resigned, I also took over his responsibilities on financial markets, financial stability, and capital markets union.
So definitely a lot to do.
Enough.
Mrs. Vestager, what are you working on currently?
Well, I have three areas of work. One is to look at mergers, so that you cannot buy yourself a nice little monopoly and set prices completely for your own benefit. So what we're looking at right now is a merger between two companies, Dow and DuPont, who are in pesticides, that kind of things, and another one, which is London Stock Exchange and Deutsche Börse, who also want to merge. Second thing we do is to look at cartels, because, you know, cartelists, they tend to agree on prices in the back office or golf hotels or any exotic place. And we do our best to catch them, because if they set prices in an agreement with one another instead of trying to do the best in the market, then you get higher prices, and the risk is that quality is not as it should be and innovation doesn't happen. And last year, we fined a cartel of truck makers, mm-hmm. five big truck makers in Europe, in a total of 3.9 billion euros, because, of course, it's very damaging for transport companies, and then, in the end, for citizens, if you cannot get the best possible truck. And thirdly, we look at the state aid, because already back then, when they wrote the Rome Treaty, they decided that bigger member states shouldn't support their companies with taxpayers' money. And one of the major areas in that is what we call fiscal aid, where a company is given a tax break that's not available to others. The most talked about cases would be the Apple case. They have to pay back a lot of unpaid taxes to Ireland, but also Starbucks are paying back taxes to the Netherlands, Fiat to Luxembourg, and a number of multinational companies are paying back money in Belgium.
Mm-hmm. So you're looking into all those cases?
Yes, and the very basic of all I do is to say, well, we want fair competition. There's no guarantees that you'll make it, but if you compete on the prices, the quality, the services, your innovation, well, if you win the markets, that's fair, we'll congratulate you. But if you cheat on the way up, that's for us to look at.
Mm-hmm. Okay, we'll probably have a lot of good questions related to those cases. There have been a lot of press related to Apple and Google in Denmark, obviously, because you're Danish. But let's just have a quick vote by raise of hands, and I think I can see you. The first question is, do you feel that your voice is being heard in the EU? The first answer is yes. I feel that my voice is being heard in the EU. How many would say that? Some. Okay. And the next possible answer is no. Slightly more. Maybe. Well, that's pretty equal. Okay. Let me just add that if you want to pose a question in Danish, feel free to do that, and I'll try and translate, because we like to have as many questions through as possible. But I'll just begin with one question up here, and we'll see if we can have some questions from the audience. And that's for you, Mr. Dombrovskis, and that's related to the financial situation of the current state of the European economy as such. We've had a tremendous financial crisis, a critical financial situation developing in Greece afterwards, and we've probably spent a lot of energy on that. But how is the Eurozone doing at the moment when it comes to economy and growth?
Well, in terms of economic growth, both Eurozone and the EU as a whole is already experiencing several years of economic recovery. It must be said, modest economic recovery. But we still expect EU's economic growth to be at 1.6% this year and at 1.8% next year. Finally, all 28 EU member states are growing. EU's GDP is above pre-crisis levels. Unemployment is down to the lowest level since beginning of the crisis. Mm-hmm. So one can say it's an ongoing recovery. But what needs to be done is indeed to strengthen this recovery and to make sure that it's sustainable.
Mm-hmm. And how do you actually do that?
Yeah,
how do you push
on, it? On this, we had set three economic policy priorities to stimulate investment, both public and private. Structural reforms to strengthen competitiveness. We can discuss more. There are a number of areas. And still fiscally responsible policies, because there's no sustainable growth without sustainable public finances. And what we are putting more emphasis in recent years is inclusive growth and reduction of income inequality, so that also citizens feel that this economic recovery which we are talking about mm-hmm. is translating into real incomes in citizens' pockets, so to say. Mm-hmm.
Margrethe, I forgot to ask you, or Mrs. Vester, I should rather call you, because obviously we know
your
each other.
Your first time will be fine.
let me just talk to you about those citizens' dialogues, and I'd like you to answer that as well. Why is it important to travel around Europe and get in touch with people like we do here?
Well, for quite obvious reasons, because we serve people. The mandate is for lending, and yet we're not elected in that respect, but we have been asked by national governments to be commissioners. We've been tested by the European Parliament, who represent all voters. And since we serve citizens, of course, well, to discuss where do we want to go, and how can we help empower you to to try to fulfill your dreams. And that cannot be done in a silo or in an ivory tower. That has to be done on ground, where we interact with one another.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Dombrowski, so why do you enjoy to travel around Europe and talk to citizens about what you do? Because what you do is really very complex.
Indeed, and that's why it's important to explain what we are doing, and also to get real feedback from the citizens. So, what are the issues which are really important? It must be said, this was initiative of this European Commission to launch those series of citizens' dialogues, mm-hmm. and this one here is like 131st citizens' dialogue we are having since the beginning of mandate of this commission in late 2014.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, so it's quite a few, and I know you've done a few, but not all of them, of course.
Obviously.
but do you sometimes feel that it can be difficult to meet, for instance, skeptical citizens that do not want a deepening of the EU and do not want a deepening of the integration in the EMU, and at the same time look at what you do and look at your desk and say, well, you know, if this structure of the EU should make sense, we should have further integration. Do you often meet that dilemma?
Indeed, and we try to respond to this dilemma by concentrating on things with clear European value added, something what we call being big on big things and small on small things, because indeed you feel that EU citizens are not expecting that EU would regulate all aspects of their lives and would get involved in everything. So you rather concentrate on some key areas where you can show that indeed doing those things together instead of in 28 different approaches in 28 countries, we can actually achieve better results.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Well, I'd like some questions from the audience now, if possible, and would like them to be related to the fields, as I mentioned, EU, EMU, or competition. Yeah, there's a question over here, please. We have a few microphones in the room moving about. So just raise your hand, and there will come a microphone for you.
My name is Søren Keldorf, and I would like to ask a question about the social pillar. In last year, the Commission played out with Mr. Dombrowski in the head about with a hearing about the social pillar. And there has been this period with the hearing, and the Danish government has been answering rather reluctant to the principles about the social pillar. And in some areas, they had directed, say, no, we don't want to be. We don't want to have principles, for example, about the wages and minimum wages. On the other hand, the European Parliament Committee on Employment and Social Relations has been rather positive to make a social pillar. And for example, in the area of wages, they have proposed that each country should have a minimum wage. A wage floor. I think it could be rather good that the EU have principles in this area in the light of the rising social inequality and what Mr. Dombrowski earlier said. So my question is, how do you look in the light of these answers which have been coming from, for example, the Danish government and other governments and the European Parliament Committee on Employment and Social Relations? Do you think it will be possible to make a social pillar which also could be supportive to making the euro function better?
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much.
Well, on a social pillar, indeed, this is a new initiative of European Commission, which was presented last year, and we had a broad consultation on this. And now we are preparing this proposal already this spring. And some of the issues, social pillar will try to address is the fact that the process of convergence within the EU has basically come to the halt since the financial and economical crisis, and while we are now in the economic recovery, we still need to regain this momentum of convergence, of course with this meaning upwards convergence. When I was talking about economic policy priorities, I was also highlighting those points on inclusive growth, dealing, reducing income inequality. Once again, social pillar will have a lot to do with this. There are certain concerns raised, including in Denmark. I was yesterday also meeting the social partners here. On the role of social partners and collective bargaining, and it's very clear when we'll work on the social partner on a social pillar, we need to preserve the role of social partners and national traditions in this. And indeed, this Danish social dialogue model is seen as a role model for many other countries, so certainly we'll do it with respect of those traditions.
Mm-hmm. And there was a question about minimum wages as well. Are you moving into that field, and how are you going to deal with that?
Yeah, this is exactly one of the questions we'll need to find this balance. We're assessing indeed the possibilities also to promote minimum wages across the EU, but we are aware that traditions in different countries are different, including in Denmark, where there's no statutory minimum wage, but it's instead sector-by-sector collective bargaining, which basically determines those minimum wages. And of course, we have to respect this tradition.
And I guess also minimum wages is just very different from country to country. I mean,
well, indeed, we are not talking about one minimum wage for all, because economic situation, productivity levels are quite different.
Thank you very much. Another question from the audience? Yeah.
I have one question in two parts. The first part goes to you, Margrethe Vestager. In the light that President Trump has seized office in America, would you go easier against American companies breaking law in Europe, such as you did go very hard against Apple and Google? Would you go easier against them now that Trump is president, in fear of a trade war between Europe and America? And then the second part to you, Mr. Dombrovskis. If there were to happen a trade war between the EU and the United States, would the European economy be able to survive that?
Mm-hmm.
Thank you.
Thank you.
Well, if you look at what we're doing now, we're not going hard at US companies, because one of our obligations is to be neutral. You can be a US company, a Russian company, a European company. It's not your flag that matters to us. You can be publicly owned or privately owned, that doesn't matter to us. You can be big, you can be small, that's not what matters to us. What really matters is that if you want to do business in Europe, play by the European rule book. And that has nothing to do with whomever is president in the United States, because we want fair competition. And I think it's very important, because what you see is in some of the cases that we have, you have very successful companies, and that, of course, is a great thing. But congratulations stops if you start to misuse your dominant position to prevent others from challenging you and try to do the same thing as you did to become big, which is to be competitive and innovative and think up new things to present to customers. And I think that is very important, because these things come, you know, from the very first treaty. It's not new, it's not something that we just invented. It is part of what made us wealthy and prosperous, that you actually have a fair chance of making it, no matter what flag you carry, no matter your ownership, no matter your size. And that's our mission. And that's my obligation to make sure that it happens.
So the answer is no. Mr. Dombrovskis?
Well,
a trade wall with the US?
Well, first of all, I would outline that Europe and US has a long-standing partnership, strategic partnership, and there is a broad support in both sides of Atlantic for this strategic partnership. So I wouldn't really be painting different doomsday scenarios. I think we have common values based on which we cooperate, and I think we need to seek this constructive engagement with the US also in the future. Of course, if the situation deteriorates, trade wars, whatever, it's going to be damaging to the economy, to the global economy, to US economy, to European economy. So we should not go down this road. We should really keep the channels open and to seek constructive cooperation.
Mm-hmm. There might be a few other questions related to Trump in the end, but I think there was another question just behind you. Yeah.
Yes. How do you suppose the economy for the EU will look after Brexit, since a rather big economy has just left us? And also, do you think that the competition for the European companies will be harder now?
Well, I probably will start with this economy and then competition for Margaret. As regards European economy, there had been done some first estimates of the Brexit to the economy. So the first estimates that was by the end of this year, the negative effect on the EU, EU 27 in this case, could be somewhere between 0.2 and 0.4 percentage points, meaning less economic growth. For UK, it could be more pronounced, between 1 and 2.5 percentage points, also depending on some of the strategic choices which UK government will have to make when starting those Brexit negotiations.
Mm-hmm.
And competition, maybe Margaret.
Well, I think it's very difficult to say, because right now, what you find is that European companies are very competitive. They do well globally. As Valdis just said, growth is coming back. There is a recovery. So they are competitive right now. And the UK, they have a very long tradition of, you know, wanting competition, challenging what was established in order to create new things. But I think the culture of fair competition is very well established, also among the 27, because there is real competition between companies from different member states. And therefore, it's still important to have a fair chance of making it what we call a level playing field. So I don't worry so much about that in connection with Brexit, because I think it's very important that you're competitive at home in Europe. If you want to make it in the global markets, then you have to make sure that you can produce the best and most efficient. And there's just, maybe we can talk about that later, on sort of climate change and environmental side of things. There can also be a benefit, because if you're competitive, well, then your use of resources is also efficient. You save energy, you save the resources of the input of whatever you're producing. And that's another, I think, benefit that's not always cherished from being competitive, that you have to be careful with the resources you use. And that, of course, will stay with us, because our obligation to fight climate change is the same before and after Brexit.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. We had another question here in the first row, second row. Yeah.
Is it okay?
Yeah.
It's about sustainable energy. We support especially the wind industry with 7-8 billion kroner per year paying by the PSO, which we have to do in another way according to the EU. But if we pay by the taxes, I suppose the taxpayers would feel the same amount of money going to the wind industry. But is it a competitive situation that the Danish wind industry compete with other countries' industries being supported in such a great way?
Question for the Competition Commissioner.
Well, there are two issues here. First, if we want to support wind energy, how do we do that? In Denmark, we have had what we call a public service obligation that we have all paid a little bit, or now in the future, where we're going to just pay the subsidies via our taxes. And what the countries have agreed on is that if you have to pay a tax, you should also be allowed to get a benefit. And some of the producers of electricity who had delivered into Danish grid, they have had to pay the tax, but they couldn't get the support. Which is why we have been working with a number of member states how to make sure that if you pay the tax, you also get the benefit. And we have found solutions with a number of countries. Now, Denmark had, of course, an open choice. Do you want to work with us to find ways to make sure that also cross-border you can get part of the benefit if you have to pay part of the tax? And they said, no, we don't want to do that. We want to find another solution. And that's completely up to Denmark to do that. Second thing is that it is up to member states to decide if they want to promote climate change solutions by, for instance, wind, solar, other things. What we do is to make sure that taxpayers' money are not wasted, that you don't support more than necessary. And one of the ways to do that is to leave a system where the subsidy is decided behind a desk by politicians or the administrators, and instead let the companies say, well, we can give you so much wind energy with this subsidy. And then the next company may say, oh, but we want that subsidy. And the third company may say, oh, but we can do it with only this very little subsidy. And that had allowed for subsidies to go down to make it much cheaper for taxpayers actually to transition the way that we produce energy to make it more affordable. And that, I think, is very important. If we want renewable energies, then it should be affordable. And we have agreed among ourselves that this is acceptable to do this kind of state aid.
Yeah, another question. I think we have one here in the front. Maybe you can just hand over the microphone.
My name is Egil Landorf. I've been a banker for a great many years, since 74, I think, so just about the beginning of EU and Denmark, or EF. I've been very strongly advocating that there is no option to the European cooperation. But I think we also must realize that the skepticism has a lot to do with that the EU, I'm not saying Europe, but EU is not very close to people's hearts. I think we have seen since Mrs. Vestager took over that the competition area has become very close to people's heart in Denmark. As a banker, however, I think that Mr. Dombrovskis' work has a lot more significance, actually, but it's very far from people's hearts. I think, for example, the Capital Markets Union is very, very important. I think the euro is really protecting people's interest much better than anything else. But how can we get this issue, the whole financial issue, much closer to people's heart? That's my question, primarily, I guess, to Mr. Dombrovskis.
Mm-hmm. And that's a good question.
Well, I would say through the economy and through the job creation. Because when we launch the banking union, when we are now developing a capital markets union, It's among other things to enable that both banking sector can play its full role in financing European economy, financing European companies, which then create jobs, and the same with the capital markets union, which we create to diversify the sources of financing so that companies are not only dependent on bank loans for financing their development, but also can go to the markets, issue their equity, issue their bonds. The way it's also in US, where actually markets have much bigger role in financing the real economy than it's the case in Europe. So it's indeed not to talk about only financial sector regulations or different instruments which we now propose in Capital Markets Union, but to show how all this work translates into better accessibility of finance to the real companies, to the SMEs. And I would say that's the way also to explain this work to the citizens.
So basically the EU should do what it has always aimed to do, create jobs and employment.
Exactly.
Do you have anything else?
No, I very much agree with this, that it's not in explaining the details and knowing the processes that you get acceptance. It is to show that it works, that we deliver. That maybe, because you've seen that, interesting Danish startups, they cannot find the capital that Valdis is talking about, and all of a sudden they have left, because they find the capital maybe in Boston or at the West Coast in the US. So they grow there, they create the jobs there, instead of here. And therefore, to make capital available for companies to grow here, the intricacies and the complexities, I don't think that one should bother anyone. But businesses should enjoy the results of the work being done. Just as well as you want to, well, you don't want to follow the baker in every step he takes, you want to eat the pastry. Mm-hmm. And I think basically we have to be satisfied with doing the right thing and making it work, and maybe not ask people to love the whole thing.
Thank you. More questions? Yeah, there's a hand there.
Karen Roy from ICT, an association that represents the biggest transport and logistics companies of Denmark. Our members work every day in the internal market. They cross borders every day, every hour. We very much support fair competition within road transport. However, we see that more and more national measures are integrated or implemented within the European Union. And for us, this is a great challenge for our companies, for our members. And my question is, what will you do? Because we very much need clear overall European rules. We need strong enforcement within our area. But we also need to ensure that these national measures like border control, like minimum wages, that has to be documented in 27 different ways in the 27 different countries that we see if it's implemented all over Europe. How will you ensure that we do not implement more national rules, that we have European rules to ensure fair competition within the European Union?
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Question related to the single market, I guess.
Yes, indeed. We can look at this on the example of logistics, but I would say it's part of the broader debate of free movement, of among other things, free movement of services, where one of the reasons why different national initiatives are appearing is often the quite big wage differences across Europe, and trade unions in some countries would say that people are providing those long-haul services with, I don't know, Bulgarian minimum wages, and this then amounts also to not fair competition. So, our approach to this in European Commission is that we actually want to address that kind of issues in a targeted way, exactly because we want to preserve free movement of labor, of services, of goods and capital if there are some concerns arising of potential abuse of the system, we rather address those concerns in a targeted way, exactly to protect. Well, on border controls, those I would say are more of the temporary nature related to the migration crisis, and European Commission is monitoring member states' decisions on reintroducing of border controls, but everyone has to agree that we were facing extraordinary situation with migration crisis, and it had to be addressed, including by temporary border controls. There are some other measures which are also assessing, for example, the road tolls and other initiatives. So this challenge is certainly there to preserve the integrity of internal market and not to allow different kind of barriers being erected. But for this, we also need to listen. So what are the concerns and how we address those specific concerns?
Mm-hmm. But what do you do in order to sort of keep red tape down? Because the intention of the single market was to sort of cut the bureaucracy and get some, as service there talked about, an equal leveled playing field.
Well, it's indeed sector by sector. On border controls, well, we are authorizing those temporary
border controls
to
like
understand
special
the
issue.
Situation. On road tolls, for example, this was also the case with some of the countries with the European Commission, which then actually had to adopt their intentions so that they are compliant with EU internal market rules. So, in a sense, you really then look sector by sector, issue by issue. And I think important element is not to be in a denial, just saying everything is fine, nothing needs to be done. If there are concerns, you rather look how to address them in a way that doesn't really hurt internal market.
Mm-hmm. And when it comes to border control, and I know that sort of that's maybe not exactly your field, but what's the time frame? What's the likely scenario when it comes to the national border control?
Well, those are typically introduced for some half-year periods, can be prolonged several times. But of course, it depends on the development of a situation. If we see that the situation of in a context of migration crisis is gradually brought back under control, we can also abolish those border controls. I mean now internal Schengen border controls. Mm-hmm. Of course, among other things, it means that we need to strengthen the protection of our external borders. That was exactly the reason why countries were introducing their internal borders, that they were not convinced that external border is protected strongly enough.
Mm-hmm. And we might touch on that later on. More questions? Yes, there's one in the middle.
Hi, I'm Donna Cotter. I'm with a global IT company here in Copenhagen. So my question will be IT related. And it'll be specifically about the EU General Data Protection Regulation. It's a new data protection regulation that'll go into effect May 2018. Pretty significant impact on any company doing business in the EU. So my question is twofold. Number one, what financial impact is the EU expecting associated with this? And then secondly, is the EU expecting to fund any innovation programs to help handle this?
Well, to be quite honest, I have no idea. because the impact assessment of these kind of proposals, they are made when the proposals are being prepared. They're quite deep to say, well, what is the impact? How will it work? What will be the costs? And then when the Commission tables the proposal, then Parliament and Council starts debating it and figure out, well, what can they then agree on to be the final outcome? And I don't think that they have done sort of new impact assessment. Actually, we're starting to do that if major changes are suggested. But I don't remember what was the financial impact back then before the proposal was tabled in itself. when it comes to innovation, for what I know from our colleague Carlos Moedas, who is responsible for research and development, in all the programs where he has a responsibility, they of course try to integrate the digital economy, how the digital sectors affect all sides of the economy. But I don't know if he has specific programs. One side thing may be that this also offers new opportunities, because one can say, well, to some businesses, yes, it's a new barrier because there are new rules to upheld according to privacy for citizens. On the other hand side, it's a possibility to innovate on privacy by design, where privacy and respecting people's personal data is not something you add on as the last thing when you have done programming, but you take it as a starter to say, well, whatever we develop, it should, in the very basic, respect privacy rules in order for people to feel that they are in control, they own their data, and they themselves decide who should take them on from there.
Thank you. More questions related to the Commissioner's portfolio? Yeah?
It's another question about another kind of competition. The competition about energy independency and energy sources. What is the status in EU for the independency of energy? I don't speak about sustainable energy, but energy sources as such, and how we are more independent, maybe also from sources from East and other places.
Well, on energy independency, indeed, this is one of the aims of EU energy policy, including in setting up the energy union, among other aims to reduce our dependence on external sources and to diversify the supplies. As regards, you mentioned specifically dependence from the East, probably from the Russia's supplies. This issue is more pronounced in Central and Eastern Europe, and also there EU has taken several initiatives by providing something what is called reverse energy flows, so connecting Eastern European countries also with Western European energy infrastructure, including in gas supplies. Talking specifically about Baltic Sea region, there is so-called Baltic Energy Market Interconnection Plan, so-called BEMIP, which also foresees number of initiatives, how to link Baltic states, how to link Poland with mainly Nordic markets, with Finland, with Sweden, but also interconnections between Lithuania and Poland. And currently, we're also working very closely in issues related with Ukraine, because there's no secret that also Russia uses gas supplies as a weapon. There are always disputes between Russia and Ukraine on gas supplies, and the Commission is also ensuring alternative routes of supply, once again, mainly reverse flows, to ensure that Ukraine also has some backup, and those countries which are dependent from transit through Ukraine are also having some backup sources of gas supplies. But of course, it's all together. You said it's not about renewables or anything, but it's also the more we produce renewable energy, the more we work on energy efficiency, meaning reducing our energy consumption, the more we're the less we are also dependent on external sources. So it's all actually linked together, but there is a whole range of initiatives to ensure diversifications of supply in those countries and regions where it's indeed a problem.
Mm-hmm. But Mr. Dombrovskis, is it basically moving in the right direction? Are Europe more self-sufficient today than 10 or 20 years ago?
Well, I would say it's certainly moving in the right direction. If you look the production of renewable energy within Europe, it has been actually quite remarkable, wind, solar, biomass, and so on. And also, I personally think this work on energy efficiency is very important. Well, maybe Denmark is among the best examples on energy efficiency, but in quite a few countries it's still a major issue, and you can get actually lots of savings and reduce your energy demand quite substantially just by improving energy efficiency.
Mm-hmm. Thank you very much. Yeah. There's a question in the back. Let's have that.
I'm the first counselor from Embassy of Turkey. I would like to ask a question about the TTIP agreement between the EU and the United States. I'm not aware if that agreement is being applied, if it's finished or not, but we are very concerned about its possible results for Turkey because of our customs union with the EU. There may be some problems of competition, fair competition, and there may be some, because some products or services will come without barriers to Turkey, there may be competition problems for our country. I would like to learn your views about possible precautions or what can be done to avoid a negative situation for the trade between the EU, United States, and Turkey. Thank you very much.
Well, I'm sort of on a first things first basis. I would worry deeply when the TTIP negotiations start again. But so far they're in the deep freezer, and even the no matter the quality of your deep freezer, there is also a limit to as for how long things can stay fresh in a deep freezer. So we don't know if they will ever come out alive. Right now. So I think that particular worry is for the future, and then even maybe for the future. One of the things that we deal with is, of course, to make sure that the results and the trade relationship that we have already can continue. Because basically our idea is to make sure that we can trade with as many as possible in a way where we sort of shape trade instead of just follow patterns. And therefore, I think for us, the trade that has been created is important, and so is the customs union. We just finalized, and I think the parliament voted on it last week, or they're just about to, the trade agreement with Canada. And I would like to take the opportunity to say that maybe the term free trade should leave the vocabulary. Because the trade agreement with Canada, I think it's this thick. It's so far away from free that you can imagine. Because when you trade with one another, it's when you trust the other also to have high standards so that you don't sort of import things that basically are against anything you have fought for back home. Which is why in the Canadian agreement you will find reference to working conditions, human rights, animal welfare. It's a modern way to think about trade. And now when we have this template, of course, we are speeding up our negotiations with Mexico, with Japan, with all the countries who say, we want to be part of world trade. We want to be part of developing standards, how this should be for the future. And this is now. And I think Europe can take a very strong lead in not just, you know, say, oh, we should trade, but also in shaping how trade should take place for the future. Because one of the reasons why the TTIP negotiation, the negotiation with the US, were very slow was, of course, that there were things that they wanted that we didn't accept and things that we wanted that they wouldn't accept. For instance, they produce some of their meat in ways that we don't accept. They slaughter chickens in a way and finalize the slaughtering process by cleaning with, I think, some chlorine product. We do it in a different way. We won't accept their way of doing things. And I think that's a very good example. Then when we don't accept things, then there is no deal. Because every trade relationship is about trusting the other to do the right thing. And therefore, it's not what we would think of as decades ago, free trade just tearing down the barriers and let anything come in. Mm-hmm. On the contrary, trade, modern trade is very much regulated.
But are you basically saying that the troubled relationship between Trump and free trade can give Europe some options because that can sort of open and deepen other relationships between other nations and the EU when the US don't want to be a part of the game?
Definitely.
The question was about Turkey. Where does that leave countries like Turkey?
Well, first of all, we have a custom union. And we have a relationship with Turkey. I think you'd say that it's a frank relationship. But it's also a relationship where we see that we have mutual interests. Right now, Turkey is housing a lot of refugees from Syria who need protection. And we try to support that to enable funding for schooling, very basic health, and cash for the refugees in order to be part of the local market so that they don't get food coming from I don't know where, but that they can shop with the local grocer and be part of the local economy, and therefore also support the local economy. Mm-hmm. And that is, of course, a very nuanced relationship, but it will develop also because we have trade relationships.
Mm-hmm. Mr. Dombrovskis, before moving into more general EU issues, I'd like to talk to you a little bit about Greece, because Greece is, as you said before, moving into a slow growth, more than 1%, I think, last year, significantly more than that. It's not a lot, but it's there. However, there's an evolving crisis with the IMF related to debt. The IMF thinks that the debt of Greece is just too big. They won't be able to handle it. So what do you think about Greece? Will it be bothering you in the year to come as well?
Well, as regards Greece, of course, it's worth looking maybe a couple of years back, because now we're talking Greece is coming back to economic growth. In 2014, we're talking Greece is coming back to economic growth. Greece is delivering on its fiscal targets. Had already in 2014 quite good job creation, and we were actually talking with that time Greek government how with the help of some kind of precautionary arrangement Greece would return to the market financing instead of this support program which they're having. Then political developments led it elsewhere. Syriza government came with new course, rejecting the program, rejecting the fiscal adjustment, everything. And unfortunately, we saw where it led. It led back to the financial instability. And with financial instability, Greece fell back into recession. There was a banking crisis. Banks were actually closed for some time. Capital controls, so it was a very negative economic development in 2015. And then also the government had to reconsider their course. In August 2015, we agreed on a new program. And it must be said that since then, this program is broadly on track. Greece is performing and even outperforming on its fiscal targets. So for this year, they have a fiscal target of primary surplus of 1.75% of GDP. They're likely to meet it. And in negotiations, we are now actually quite close to finalize also discussions about next year's budget and Greece reaching a primary surplus target of 3.5% of GDP. Mm-hmm. And it's within reach. So what's currently going on? Currently, there are going on negotiations on a second review of the program, and completion of the second review would allow us to move forward with the next disbursement, so provide finance to Greece. And some in terms of meeting the program conditionality, as I said, we are actually quite close. So there is a discussion of IMF involvement in a program. what IMF is saying, they are having more pessimistic macroeconomic scenario and more pessimistic view on Greek public finances. Well, we must see where they stand exactly now. Some time ago, they were standing saying that with the measures, according to our forecast, Greece will reach 3.5% surplus. IMF thinks Greece will reach only 1.5% surplus. Mm-hmm. So there is 2% of GDP gap. So how it was agreed to bridge this is basically by contingency mechanism. Basically, should this very pessimistic scenario materialize, that Greece stand ready to provide additional measures. Mm-hmm. And this is still something where we are, where those discussions are revolving to ensure full IMF participation in the program. But I would say now it would be very important to stay on course from both sides, also from the Greek government, from EU, from IMF, because with Greece now returning to the growth, and we actually expect Greek economy to rebound quite strongly this year, with Greece substantially overperforming on its fiscal targets. Last year, fiscal target was overperformed maybe something like 1% of GDP, if not mm-hmm. more. Not to fall back once again in this financial instability, because then without financial stability, there will be no economic growth. Mm-hmm. So it's a difficult moment. It's quite a critical moment right now, but I think it's very worthwhile from all sides to give this final push, to make this final effort, and to make sure that a program is on track, and with this, Greek economy will be rebounding strongly.
Okay. I think we've got about half an hour left, so I'd like to move into more general EU questions, but I'd like to have a hand vote before that. And I think we have a slide with some different options. The question is, in your opinion, what should be the main priority of the European Union? And we have four different choices here. Who would say economic growth and jobs? Who's going for investment and innovation? Migration? And climate? Oh? So climate and growth is the winner. Do we agree on that? Yeah. Okay.
They're too easily combine, actually.
In Denmark, at least, we have quite a few businesses moving into that field.
I think in a number of member states, you find that more and more businesses see that this is what's going to happen. Mm-hmm. This is where we want to be. And as Valdis said, things are moving forward. The transitioning of the European economy to be sustainable is well on track. Mm-hmm. And therefore, the probabilities to link in to be global market leaders in these areas, well, that's a very, very good potential.
Brilliant. Okay, let's take general questions. Could be immigration, could be Brexit, could be Trump, could be anything you like. Yes.
Thank you. Mette Frobenius, radio host and stand-up comedian. Sometimes when we see a decision made either in the parliament or in the commission and there's a huge majority, afterwards, the politicians go back to their own parliaments or their own media or their voters and say, look what I have achieved. Look what I managed to do in the EU. So they don't give the credit to the parliament or the commission or the council for that sake. How do we change that so that people become aware of that it's actually a European decision and not somebody that one person fought for in the parliament or in the commission? And could that be a way of persuading skepticism towards the European Union, that we have to fight these things together and not national, individual by individual?
Classical scenario, Mr. Dombrovskis.
Well, I think this is something what heads of state and government of European countries are now discussing in Valletta. How to make sure that Europe is a success. And this is also communicated. And indeed, it's primarily the question to the heads of state and government. I have myself, I have been Prime Minister of Latvia for almost 5 years, so I know exactly how this is happening in national politics. And this requires, I think, some change of the attitude, that you do not go to the council saying, now we go to fight for our country's interests, and then you come back and say, this is what I got, and if I don't get something, oh, you know, this Brussels, they are imposing this on us. Indeed, it's in the hands of heads of state and government. We see that EU is in difficult situation, and it's also time to reconsider how we communicate about the EU, that we show where this European value added is, and not always, so to say, import all the successes and then try to export all the failures to the EU.
Mm-hmm. Exactly. But this is very difficult because any politicians need a re-election.
But I think about this question almost every day. I think it's the core question. And I think it's completely fair that politician wants to be re-elected and that we are trying to present what we do to potential voters in the best possible way. That cannot be changed. That would be like changing the tides or making the globe turn the other way
it's
around.
It's democracy, we don't want to change it.
No, that we have to take for a given, that politicians want to look their best to their voters. But I think as a voter, maybe we could try to persuade our politicians to say, well, fine, you did almost the whole thing yourself, but who helped on the way? Who were part of this? Because we can see that there are many more politicians, and maybe they did a little as well, in order to get the right incentives for the politicians, and I know this as well as Valdis do, firsthand, that successes are imported and failures are exported. So I think it's in the relationship between us as voters and us as politicians that we will have to say, well, the European part of our democracy, how does it help you as a national politician to become something attractive for voters? And if we can do that trick, then we can change and stop sort of this import-export of success and failure.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Yeah.
I think this is a very good link to the next question, which must concern Brexit and how you're going to deal with Brexit negotiations. After Theresa May's speech and the discussion and debate in Parliament in London, it's pretty clear what the British side is planning and what they want to achieve. That is a complete break with the European Union, standing completely outside of the internal market rules, the Court of Luxembourg, etc. But we've not heard a single word about what Europe is planning in this respect. We've not heard a single idea as to how you're going to approach these negotiations, what are going to be our priorities. In fact, are you just going to wait for 2 years and then let things happen by default? Because that is what could happen. So I would like to hear from you, what is being planned, what is being thought in terms of negotiation procedure, process. When we enlarge the union, it's pretty clear what we do. We have 24 negotiating chapters and we go through them one by one. There's a model for that. There's no model for Brexit or any other exit. Please explain to us what you have in mind.
I think comes by design that currently not much is being said about EU's position. Because already before the referendum, but very clearly immediately after the referendum, EU institutions said it very clear that we will not be engaging in any pre-negotiations or commentings before UK will come up with a formal notification of its intention to leave the EU. And that's what is for us a starting point of negotiations. Currently, what we are observing, those are internal preparations within the UK. Once they will come with a notification, that's when they have notified, that's when we start negotiating. Of course, if we do not comment it publicly and do not pre-negotiate with UK, it doesn't mean that we are not doing our preparatory work. This preparatory work is well underway. We are doing internal mapping exercise. From European Commission, we also have nominated our chief negotiator, Michel Barnier. We know other EU institutions are also nominating their negotiators, doing preparations, doing mappings. And as soon as notification will come, and presumably it will come next months, we will start negotiating. And one thing which indeed was clear from Theresa May speech was that she has accepted that access to the EU internal market comes with conditions, because initial position was indeed we don't like free movement, we don't like European Court of Justice, we don't like contributions to EU budget and many other things, EU rules and regulations. Can we have access to the EU internal market anyway? And all EU institutions were consistently saying, no, that's not the case. Those are the conditions if you want to have access to the EU internal market. So it was a strategic choice which UK had to make. And in Theresa May's speech, we heard this answer. So that UK is not willing to have access based on those conditions, but at least it provided some clarity and some direction for a future work.
What will be the impact on the internal market if and when the Brits are leaving?
Well, I already was mentioning those assessments of the impact on the economy, but those are more like a short-term assessments, because within which we did in the middle of last year for until the end of this year, because UK within that time frame will still be a full member of the EU with all rights and obligations. On the further impact, I would say at this stage it's premature to say, because it will depend on many different modalities which will be negotiated during those Brexit negotiations. And only when kind of a general outline of the deal will start emerging, we'll be able to provide some more also clear estimate of what the economic impact is going to be.
Okay, Vestager, in more general terms, why do you think we see Brexit, we see huge support for Marine Le Pen and forces moving away from Brussels and sort of trying to disintegrate Europe? Why do we see that?
Well, I think to some degree that Brexit was 30 years in the making. Because I think even, you know, even a drop of water can make a hole in a stone. If every day, every hour, every minute there is a drop. And what you have seen, if you've been following the UK debate about the European part of our democracy, it has been quite hostile. And eventually you cannot turn around after having been bitching about your wife for 30 years, 3 years before the silver wedding, to say, oh, but she's so nice. We really want to have the party. It doesn't work like that. You as a politician, you also harvest what you sow. Mm-hmm. And that, I think, is a very important takeaway, at least for me, as having worked in politics, to be very careful, because eventually things come back to you. And on the question of making plans, I read the legislation backing up the UK referendum. It's done in 15 seconds, because it's just one sentence. There is to be held a referendum of whether the United Kingdom should remain or leave the European Union, and that's it. Which sort of leaves it quite open what happens next. And therefore, I don't think it's for us, the 27, to make plans for the UK. They are so open, they definitely have to do that themselves. We should make plans for the 27, because it's the UK who wants to leave. We are here to stay. And we then take the plans from the heads of state and government and put that into practice on climate change, on trade, on migration, on protecting refugees, on creating jobs. This is our obligation. And one of the things that I admire with Michel Barnier is that he sees himself, of course, as the EU negotiator, but also as the Irish and the Danish and the Greek and the Cyprus negotiator, because it's not the same thing. I think between 40 and 50% of the Irish agricultural export goes to the UK. It's not a detail. It is very, very important. But they, of course, the Greek, they have other things to do. They don't think that this is the most important issue. I think one third of, if not more, of fish brought into Danish harbors, they come out of British waters. So this is an issue. And therefore, I think it's very, very good that he has this attitude that he's both the EU and the member states and being very well aware that what is very important in one member state is of not much important in another member state in order to have a outcome that is dealing with all these issues.
Thank you. Let's have some more questions. Yes, I think there's one over here, and then we're trying to move around in the room afterwards.
Thank you very much. It's really great to listen to this dialogue, and I was astonished when the commissioner said that this is the 131st. First or second. It's really good. I'm ambassador of Slovenia here. I didn't want to take the floor because the general public should have the priority, but I wanted to pose a question. Obviously, we are moving now into this debate in Valletta and further on. Some people are advocating, those who are a little skeptical of this supranational, because all the crises we went through during the past in Europe, the only answer they are saying to the problems was further deepening of the EU. Now some are advocating from the EU leaders that we should give more attention to the national, so to say, to find the right balance. What are commissioners thinking about this? Mm-hmm. Can we actually accelerate our growth, our competitiveness, obviously to be a global player, to set out the standards on the supranational or national, or where is the balance? Thank you.
Well, we are trying to find this balance with this approach which I outlined before, being big on big things and small on small things. Also, after the Brexit, this discussion came to the EU, okay, so what do we do in this situation? 27 member states came with a clear statement that while one member state has decided to leave, EU remains indispensable for the rest of us, and we are determined to make a success out of it. So the question was, okay, but so what are the areas, what do we do now? And indeed, the agreement was that we are not now engaging in some kind of a new grand design, because there may be a limited appetite for that, but we rather concentrate on practical things where we can show that we can work together as the EU and come up with a tangible results. There were four areas identified in so-called Bratislava roadmap on facilitating investment, where it's clear also European added value. On Capital Markets Union, we touched upon this very briefly, on digital single market, where obviously by nature it's something which should be cross-border, and on security, where if we want to preserve Schengen, security cooperation is going to be very important. So there were four practical areas where we can really get tangible results as a EU. And of course, we must see what will emerge of today's summit in Valletta. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. But just a short comment.
Yes, it's just that we have this full catalogue of dark analysis, of sort of doomsday predictions. And it is as if it's completely overshadowing what Europe has going for herself. This is probably the best place to live on Earth in history, especially if you're a woman. It doesn't come any better. And we have, you know, world-class research and development, amazing infrastructure, the best, most prosperous market in the world. We have everything going for ourselves. And I think we have to detox from the Trump Twitter account and focus on Europe. We have so much to do because we have this full catalog of problems, but those can be solved. And as we speak, jobs are being created, unemployment is falling, businesses are approaching new markets, and that has to be part of the story because it's there and it's for real.
Mm-hmm. Are you working for the EU?
Yes, just as, because it's a European part of our democracy and it's just as integrated as a national part of the democracy. And the only thing I really haven't done yet is the local part of the democracy. So maybe I'll be the mayor of Lesso in 20 years.
That's probably nice. Let's have as many questions as possible because we're coming to an end slowly. Let's have the one back there. Yes.
So exactly, sorry, my name is Cecilia Helm. I couldn't agree more that the EU is a fantastic place to live, especially for women, and the EU has a lot going for it, or for us. But I still feel that I would feel much safer knowing that we, meaning the citizens of the EU, the member states, the institutions of the EU, has a plan or thinks about a strategy on how we can counter the attempts from Putin and Breitbart and Trump to weaken the cohesion of the EU, as we see how they're actively trying to meddle in the democracy in Germany and in France before their elections. Do we have a plan? Mm-hmm.
Well, I think this is part of the plan, to actually talk, because I don't think that there is sort of an institutional fix. I don't think that learning by heart words like interinstitutional relationship doesn't bring you any good. Because there's no new treaty that will solve it. It's personal. Now it's getting personal. Mm-hmm. Do we engage for full? Every politician, every employee, every citizen to make something happen that actually works for us. And that is why citizens' dialogue is part of this plan. To get talking, and not just to explain, but to talk, to find ways to say, well, I got inspired. Now I want to do something else today, something that I didn't do yesterday. And I think that's the basics of any plan that we really want to make that change happen as a personal thing.
Mr. Dombrovskis, I have to ask you about Trump and his Russia policy, because you're from Latvia and you know what it's like being very, very close to Russia. What do you think of Trump's foreign policy when it comes to Russia? What is it trying to achieve and what are the consequences for Europe?
Well, first, of course, we must see what this policy will really be, but I would say there are already for several years quite a lot of worries in Latvia and also in other Baltic states. It's after the Russia's invasion in Ukraine. There was lots of worries in the Baltic states what it actually means and what is possibly next. So one very important step was that from the US, from the EU, there was a clear response that changing borders in 21st century Europe by military force is not acceptable. There were sanctions, there were strong diplomatic reactions, non-recognition of annexation, and so on and so forth. Of course, in Baltics, what is was also very important, which is still ongoing, is actually presence of NATO troops, which has been substantially strengthened since this invasion in Ukraine. So first thing, what of course would be important is not to reverse this policy and stay united as a Western democratic world and show Russia that that kind of behavior is not acceptable.
But you say stay united, which means Trump and the EU stays united, but that's not the sort of likely scenario at the moment.
Well, that is exactly what we need to see. I think there are some reasons for concern. But of course, then you, if you listen to different people in administration, you hear entirely different things. If you listen, for example, to General Matisse, you hear very clear commitment to the NATO, to the EU allies, to the collective security of the NATO, and also very clear assessment of the Russia's policy. Mm-hmm. So it still. We need to see what the real policy vis-à-vis Russia will be.
What exciting it is.
Well, as I said, there are certainly concerns, and in Baltic countries, people are actually quite concerned already for several years.
Mm-hmm. Thank you. Right. A few more questions. Yes, let's have another one up there.
Thank you very much. Just going back to the former slide with the four main priorities of the EU where we had a choice, I have a suggestion that the first priority should really be communicating about the European project. Because I really believe that if the EU was a private company and I was talking to a consultancy company helping me to promote my company, I would get the advice, do some rebranding. And so my question is really, about the cooperation with national politicians, because I think national politicians, national organizations, citizens, those are the ones who has to understand the European project, to like the European project, and not talking about the EU as something independent going on around Rue de la Loire in Brussels. And it's actually a sort of the EU, I'm sorry to say that, but it's becoming modern among people who normally was a supporter of the European project to talk sort of skeptical about the European project. It's not modern anymore to be enthusiastic about the whole thing. So my question is, how do we engage national politicians more? I buy the argument from Vestager that of course it's all about promoting and getting re-elected. Mm-hmm. But could Dombrovskis, for instance, sell a story about the European project being very good to growth and jobs? Why not give that story to all the national finance ministers so they can get that in the local newspaper? And then maybe in a small note mentioning that it's about figures from the EU something. What about citizens? Could we look at education? I'm very happy to see all these young people here today. That's because it's all about your future, the Europe that you will live in from now. Mm-hmm. Thank you.
But just one point. For me, communication is not something that you can put on top. As an add-on. The story you tell will have to be for real, which is why what Valdis said in the beginning, that we focus on things that should be done in the European part of the democracy. Because if we ever spend an hour doing something that could be done better or as good in the national democracy or the local democracy, then we have wasted our time and not done our job, because there are things that we can only do together. And this is why we are changing the way we work, in order to have a better story to tell, so that the communication is not some smooth add-on to try to look good. It's for real. It's a story that has a bite and a moral and a conclusion that we are doing better, because we're doing what we can only do together. And we find that it's not to tell national politicians and citizen about the EU, it's the citizens and the national politicians who are the EU. The citizens who elected the members of the European Parliament, the ministers of government who go to councils meeting and take decisions. We're all in it together. Which is why I try to be a little careful with my language to talk about the European part of our democracy, because I feel that the letters EU has just been an abbreviation for the others.
But Mr. Dombrovskis, I guess the problem here is, when it comes to branding, that the EU is not a private company. It's a hugely complicated matrix of 28, soon 27 countries and politicians trying to get themselves re-elected and so many different agendas. So I guess it's very, very difficult to put the EU on one formula.
Well, this is a famous question. If I want to talk with the EU, whom do I call? I think it's still not quite answered to this stage. But I don't think that the EU's complexity is a problem. Well, we are union of 28 or potentially 27 countries. Those 27 countries have different approaches, different interests. It all needs to be reconciled. And we need to listen to different opinions and accommodate them. So it's not going to be easy. That's why we have, I would say, this quite heavy decision-making processes. But I would say, especially for a smaller countries, I don't think just streamlining everything to very quick, so to say, command would work for the benefit of those countries. It's important that indeed all countries and different stakeholders are being heard. So, and I agree with what Margaret was saying. So, it's more about to show what we are delivering as a EU. It's not so much on selling this institution or that institution, because it's indeed complex and it's likely to stay quite complex. But to show what as a EU we can achieve together and concentrate on this.
Ladies and gentlemen, we're coming to an end, unfortunately, even though there are probably a lot of good questions left out there. I'd like to end with a hand vote again. You have to answer the question whether you feel that this event has improved your knowledge about the EU. Yes? That's nice. And no? Okay. Well, that's fewer than expected. Thank you very much. Okay. Now, before finalizing this session, I'd like to put your attention to the fact that the Commissioner for Employment and Social Affairs, Marianne Thyssen, is coming to Copenhagen next week in a similar arrangement. She's coming for Citizens Dialogue Thursday. And she's going to talk about social aspects related to labor markets, jobs, inclusion, welfare, all things that are highly relevant, I think, to the Danish political agenda. So if you want to join and if you enjoyed today, please join also Thursday. It's free, just as this arrangement. Thank you very much, Mr. Dombrovskis. Thank you very much, Mrs. Vestager, for joining us here today. Thank you.